join me in the responsive reading. When sorrow comes, let us accept it simply as a part of life.
Let the heart be open to pain. Let it be stretched by it.
An open heart never grows bitter, or if it does, it cannot remain so.
Anguish, like ecstasy, is not forever.
There comes a gentleness, a returning quietness, a restoring stillness.
This too is a door to life.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Bruce Morrison. Welcome to Fountain Street Church. I am married to the wonder-filled Carolyn Kempter Morrison, and we have two daughters, Lee, who attends Wellesley College outside of Boston, and Isabel, currently searching for her own college, one to match her passion for music. Lee and Isabel have graced you with music over the years, first in junior choir, then in Ars Nova, and when that was dissolved, an all-female group called Shavesh. Lee and Isabel have also benefited immensely from Fountain Street Church Character School, which meets almost every Sunday during the school year. My friends, we don't realize what a gem we have in this character school. The leaders and volunteers in character school teach our kids, our future leaders, that it is okay to be independent, inquisitive, and strong-minded, all while reviewing stories of the Bible and sharing life's roses and thorns. In short, we build character. Years ago, my then 4.5-year-old daughter, Isabel, and I would sit in on Wright McCarver's junior choir practice up in the choir room. Lee and the other singers were learning the songs. Although Isabel couldn't read and was 1.5 years from the so-called first grade entry point into the choir, one Sunday, when Wright announced to the group that they would be singing in the big church the next Sunday, Isabel turned to me and said, "I'm singing too." Where did that come from? Character. Knowing she was pushing the age boundaries, I said, "Let's ask Mr. McCarver." His response? "As long as she knows the songs, she is welcome." Well, she did. And the next Sunday, she began a great relationship with musical groups. Another story. A few years back, my 16-year-old daughter, Lee, didn't think it was right that LGBT teens didn't feel all that welcome at their normal high school proms. So guess what? She started the first alternative prom in Grand Rapids, coordinating other fountain clubbers to help her in everything needed to make it happen for a party of 100 right here at Fountain Street Church. In the planning stages, there were disappointments and pushbacks, yet she persisted because she knew in her heart that there should be a place for everyone, that welcome, everyone feel welcome in such an important milestone in life. The alternative prom continues now every year. How did she do it? Character. Finally, I asked a 7- or 8-year-old character school student a few weeks ago, "What is most important to you about character school?" The response? "I like learning about other cultures." My friends, could you ask for more? Character. These kids are our future. And Fountain Street Character School makes it happen. What can you do? Help out. Be a pen pal. Support a tower clubber on their coming of age trip. Buy a Fountain Club fundraiser potato and say, keep the change. Increase or begin your gift to Fountain Street Church. The return on this investment will be manyfold as we venture into a sometimes scary future. You'll hear about it on Senior Sunday when those who are graduating tell us they could not have done it without you. If you are new to Fountain Street, we welcome you and all people, young and old, to explore the world along a Judeo-Christian path. You may settle on one religion or, like me, mix them all up. Join us for coffee or tea in the social hall after the service. Learn more, free the mind, grow the soul, change the world. Thank you.
Welcome ashore, sit yourself down, and meet the best innkeeper in town. As for the rest, all of them crooks, rooking the guests and cooking the books. Seldom do you see honest men like me, agent of good intent, who's content to be master of the house, doling out the charm, ready with a handshake and an open palm. Tells a saucy tale, makes a little stir, customers appreciate a bon vivre, glad to do a friend a favor. Doesn't cost me to be nice, but nothing gets you nothing, everything has got a little price. Master of the house, keeper of the zoo, ready to relieve him of a sou or two, watering the wine, making up the weight, picking up their knickknacks when they can't see straight. Everybody loves a landlord, everybody's bosom friend. I do whatever pleases Jesus when I bleed him in the end. Master of the house, quick to catch your eye, never wants a passerby to pass him by. Servant to the poor, butler to the great, comfort a philosopher and lifelong mate. Everybody's food companion, everybody's chaperone. Lock up your valises, Jesus, when I skin you to the bone. Enter ashore, lay down your load, unlace your boots and rest from the road. This weighs a ton, travel's a curse, but here we strive to lighten your purse. Here the goose is cooked, here the fat is fried, and nothing's overlooked till I'm satisfied. Food beyond compare, food beyond belief, mix it in a mincer and pretend it's beef. Kidney of a horse, liver of a cat, filling up the sausages with this and that. Residents are more than welcome, bridal suite is occupied. A reasonable charge is plus some little extras on the side. Charge them for the lice, extra for the mice, 2% for looking in the mirror twice. Here a little slice, there a little cut, 3% for sleeping with the window shut. When it comes to fixing prices, there's a lot of tricks he knows. How it all increases, all in bits and pieces, Jesus, it's amazing how it grows. Master of the house, quick to catch your eye, never wants a passerby to pass him by. Servant to the poor, butler to the great, comfort a philosopher and a lifelong mate. Everybody's boon companion, here's everything I've got. Dirty bunch of geezers, Jesus, what a sorry little lot.
But God Almighty, have you seen what's happened since? Master of the house isn't worth my spit. Comforter, philosopher, and lifelong cunning little brain, regular Voltaire. Thinks he's quite a lover, but there's not much there. What a cruel trick of nature landed me with such a louse. House.
Master of the house.
Master of
to the great.
Hypocrite and toady and inebriate.
Everybody bless the landlord. Everybody bless his spouse. Everybody raise a glass.
Raising up the master's
Everybody raise a glass to the master of the house.
As you may have seen, our bench is now richer with our governing board chair, Brian Walters, and our volunteer ministries coordinator, Jennifer Kinney, because this is the time when we welcome and recognize our new members. Elizabeth, would you get us started? It's there. Just start talking. You're okay.
Okay. Wow. Hello. 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 Yes, yes. My voice carries. This morning, it is a delight to honor our newest members, those who have signified their desire to be full members of the life of this congregation by signing our official membership book. I want to say a little something about the process that some of these new members have been involved with in the last couple of weeks and months. Some of them just very recently have joined us in the pews or in our program. Some have been coming for some time, but it was this season that they have decided to make it official. And for some of them, we offered them a four-part series, a new membership inquirer series to get to know one another, to get to know Fountain Street Church. And so we spent our first session a few weeks ago talking about our spiritual journeys, talking about our soul teachers, and talking about our passion. What we're passionate about. Oftentimes that's passion with an S in plural. So it's just been a delight to start that journey here with them at Fountain Street Church. And then the following session, we spent some time talking about this church and this place and had some members and lay leaders really share about their experience of being part of the meaningful work of this place. So thank you. And we're going to have a celebration for them next month as well, a chance to gather together for a time of community. So as I read your names, please come forward and join us. Amy and Olivia Devine, Erica Olshansky and Phil Pruhl, Mark St. Amour and Andrea McLean, Liz DeBraber, Terry and Anita Nyheis, Will and Pam Wanamaker, Ashley Glupker and John Dupe, Creighton Boyke, Chris and Teresa Miller, and Sue Shakuski. Come on down, come on up.
Oh my. So why don't you come in front here so we can see you? Compassed about as we are by so great a cloud of witnesses.
Yes, welcome, welcome. It's good to see everyone. So why do we come to church? Here is what some of the youngest among us have said in seasons past. To express reverence and awe and gratitude for our many blessings. To pause in our busy lives to think about what is most important. And to be with others who care about and celebrate life. Of course, we can feel reverence and awe and gratitude anytime and on our own. But without other people, we cannot know the fullness of reverence, the depth of awe, the tenderness of gratitude. Without other people, without community, sometimes we just don't take enough time from what we might feel is urgent to ponder ultimate things. This is one of many reasons why congregations exist.
But why this congregation? You had hundreds of choices. In fact, one might say there are too many choices among churches today. Well, those who become members here, you're disciples. Did you know that? You are disciples in the original sense, which means student, always learning. Am I correct? Of course you are. Members of Fountain Street Church are lifelong learners of life. Of truth, the truth within each of us and the truth that connects all of us. They are disciples of goodness, filled with the hope that we can all be better than we have been and must become if the world is to survive. They are disciples of beauty, not as the mere decoration of life, but as a prophetic sign of its fullness.
But we are also more than students. I believe that we are always both and, students and teachers, each and every one of us. As teachers, we share our wisdom, our insights, our life experience, our capacity to connect. In many ways, we are prophets living out our principles, and we are, we might dare to say, even saviors. Saviors, redeeming the world, reconciling the world through acts of love and compassion and connection. I have a question for you. Do you, by joining this church, dedicate yourself to a life of learning and teaching, of discipleship? If so, please answer, I do. This is a mighty task, one that does take a lifetime, a journey that never ends. It is not easy, and we all need help on that journey.
And that's why the rest of these people are important, because this church promises to stand with you and sustain you as you walk the path of a liberal faith. Now, will you, the congregation, welcome them as fellow disciples of truth and goodness and beauty? Will you learn from them as well as teach them, follow them as well as lead them, receive their gifts as well as give your own? If you are willing to do that, say, we will.
We will.
I think you got a good vote. Sharing our vision of a world where everyone is a student, a teacher, a prophet, and a savior is our mission. We bid you all, new and old in membership and new and old in years, to continue to free your mind, grow your soul, and change your world.
So we task you to uncover your light and let it shine. Go forth out into the world and into this community with our support in letting your light shine. We have some gifts for you and a handshake of welcome from our governing board chair and volunteer ministries coordinator. So, and let's sing a little.
Thank you. whenever a Torah portion comes to the end of a book like Genesis, Leviticus, and all them, they always stand up at the end and say, Chazak, Chazak, v'nichazek, strong, strong, let us be strengthened. That text reminded me of that moment. And sometimes we get our strength from being shoulder to shoulder with someone. Yeah, who's gonna make me, says the kid on the playground, me and my 10 friends, you know? That's how it happens, strength in numbers. Well, it's been a bit of a rainbow week here at our little place in Lake Wobegon. Who expected on Friday that Judge Friedman would be issuing an order like he did? And you see these things, we use them for, we should remember that we are a place that has a rainbow in it. And so I think it's time to be a little festive, don't you? Yeah, no, it's been stayed, but in my opinion, that's temporary. In fact, I hope some of you will come with me. Come with me down to Rosa Parks Circle later today, because you say, well, we're done now. We just got to first base, guys. We're on base now, so that's great. We have work to do. So that's great. I really liked that. That was wonderful. It came as a surprise, and a little jealous that my buddy and former Fountain Streeter Bill Freeman was over in Muskegon, where they had a compliant clerk. He did 49 weddings yesterday. That's not what, he was kind of like being Elvis in Vegas almost. I was so bloody jealous. So that's why I need the state to end now, because it is, hear me, mark my word, I expect one of the, if not the first, one of the very first weddings to take place in this house. And if there's money involved, I will pay for it myself, because we are a place that needs to be a friend of the LGBT community at all. The all-prom, you heard about that earlier. That was an idea of our fountain club. No grown-ups had a thing to do with that. So we're taking our lead that the LGBT community is our community one way or the other. And if y'all want to get married, have I got a place for you to do it? There you go. So I want to get out our rainbow here. But when you say it was a rainbow kind of week, you also mean, if you know what rainbows are made of, that they're made up of what? Sunshine and rain. So I had a little rain in my week this week. Nothing that had involved you. I have a dear friend, someone I've known for over 20 years. And his health is declining really fast. It's very sad because, well, I don't know about you, but, well, a lot of years ago when I was a kid, someone who was into astrology did my horoscope and told me, because I'm an Aquarius, that I'm never going to have many friends, but the friends I have will be very dear. And while I love all of you, when I want to be not a minister, I can count on one hand the people I can do that with. And this is one of them. So just take off a finger. So I have some pain in my life that a dear friend, someone I've known and loved, is coming perhaps close to the end of his life too early. Well, that's true of anyone you love. It's always too early. So sunshine and rain at once. But that's the way of life, isn't it? You know, bad things happen, good things happen. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, right? That's what Job says. We all know the book of Job. You know the story, right? God sitting up there in heaven in the fable and says, behold my servant Job, is there not a better man on earth? He gives me thanks every day, slaughters a few beasts at the right time, and he's doing great. He is a model citizen in my world. And Satan, who by the way is not God's opponent, but literally the devil's advocate, says, well, maybe he wouldn't be so devoted to you if he didn't have so much money and all those fine family members and wasn't the picture of health even in old age. And God and Satan make a bargain. God says he would do that even if he lost all of that. And Satan says, put your money where your mouth is, G. And G says, go, take it all away. Take away all of it except his life. He will still be faithful to me. And God was right. Storms, armies, marauding things come and kill his livestock, steal off his servants, demolish and obliterate his family, and he's finally given a wasting, awful disease that makes him pained all the time and sits under a tree feeling miserable, literally picking at his scabs. And his friends come to comfort him. One of them is named Eliphaz. And articulating the view very common at the time, he said, well, you know, no one's perfect here. Job, you screwed up somewhere, and this is God's recompense for you being a sinner. And Job will have none of it. I've done nothing wrong. I've obeyed all the rules. I've made all the sacrifices. I am not only devoted to God, I've been compliant. I am being afflicted unjustly. He's essentially accusing God of not being fair. Well, at some point in this dialogue, God actually turns up. Job says, I demand an explanation. And God shows up and says, who is this who darkens counsel without knowledge? You can imagine it coming out of the head of Oz, you know, in the movie. Whoa. Then the knee shaking going on. And then God says to Job and Job's friends, gird up your loins like a man. I will question and you will answer me. In other words, God is saying, I'm not accountable to you guys. It's a very frustrating ending because it doesn't settle the matter of why people suffer unjustly. Because that's what the story is about. Why do people suffer? Why do people suffer unjustly in particular? And God says, that's not for you to know. You won't get it even if I told you. He says, shut up. That's essentially what he says. And Job says, you're right. You're God. I'm not. I regret that I ever brought up the whole subject. But he also talks to Job's friends, Eliphaz and friends, and said, you, go out and sacrifice a bunch of animals for pretending to explain me to Job. The whole point is to leave us with a sense of mystery about the nature of suffering. And we all know it's true because who in this world has not suffered yet? No one, right? We've all had an affliction of some kind, illness, loss of a job, sorrow in a family, unemployment. We've all suffered. Each and every one of us. And I want to take up this riddle in the next two Sundays, this one and next. And I could give you all sorts of theories to go along with this. That would be great. But I'd rather tell you a story. So back in 1993, 21 years ago now, I had a member of my previous church. This was in Austin, Texas. And his name was Haywood W. McGriff. I've told you this story before, but some of you may not have heard it. But good stories can be told many times, and we can learn something each time. Haywood McGriff was a ballet dancer. This is not a ballet dancer here, so I was in awe. He was tall and beautiful and black as night and as gay as it gets. And he taught at the University of Texas, and he was a member of my church, and I was having such a bromance with him. He liked me. In fact, after the Clinton election, he gave me a gift. I still have it. It's one of my dearest possessions, a copy of Maya Angelou's poem On the Pulse of Morning. He gave this to me. I can barely hold it without crying. You can tell the story is not going to end right. Well, Haywood was a dancer. He was gay. He had AIDS. And in April of 94, he was in hospice care, and I went to see him. I wasn't alone. He had many of his friends. And I held his hand. It was cold and dry. But even lying on a bed, he still looked beautiful in a way only a person who knows his body can be beautiful. He died on Mother's Day that year, May the 8th, and I did the service for him. Now, the reason you need to know this is that I didn't suffer the way he did, but I lost a friend. And I also buried Axel Picado of AIDS and Alan. And while AIDS never touched me personally in the sense that it touched my body or my beloved, it touched my friends and it touched my people. And I've lit candles and attended vigils and gone to services. So when the Red Project this year wanted to hold their AIDS Day service here, it was like redemption had come. Yes. Yes, we can do this. We have this notion in the world that somehow we get our just desserts, don't we? Everything happens for a reason, right? There's a congressional candidate in the Chicago area. She made the news recently, Suzanne Atanas. So she's not a, I'm not going to keep her identity secret from you. She won the GOP nomination, so she's not just an outlier now. She represents the Republican Party and has been on record saying that tornadoes and this winter and autism are all the result of same-sex marriage and LGBT rights in the country. Needless to say, actually, I should say it, because I want to make sure my Republican friends do not feel bad. The establishment party is saying we're not with her. But they are now, because the voters voted. And this is a notion we all have, at least from our game. You get what you deserve, just desserts. You put your finger in a socket, you get the, you know what it means, it's cause and effect. And this is the way people have dealt with suffering for generations. That's what motivates Job's torment of friends. They were saying, well, it wouldn't have happened to you if you hadn't been bad somewhere, because the notion is that nothing bad happens except that you kind of deserve it. And it's all over the place. Like I said, even in Chicago. AIDS is the most recent example. Well, if they weren't gay, they wouldn't have got it. Well, maybe in a cause and effect way you could say that, but it wasn't the gayness that did it, really. Just talk to all the lesbians who never had AIDS and won't ever get it. So we know that there's this desire to blame ourselves and others for the bad things. Anyone here been reading Paul Ryan's comments on welfare and that, you know, cultures of dependency? Someone pointed out this morning on the news that in drug testing welfare recipients in Florida, they spent $5.8 million in drug tests and found four people. This to save money from being wasted on the poor, you understand, because the poor obviously don't work because they're drug-addled or something like that. So this idea that people are poor because they want to be or should be, or people get AIDS because they want it or want to be gay, or that we are black because we want to be black, or that we're male because we want to be male, somehow this seems to be persistent. But, you know, I don't think it holds up. And I don't think you agree either. And yet we're left with this riddle of suffering. Why does it happen? That's the hard part. I need to find my second story here to remind myself where I'm going. I don't want to get off on the wrong foot. Oh, yeah. I think I already covered that. That's cool. There it is. No, this is another important and sad story. Just desserts are still a part of our way of thinking about sin and suffering. 10 years earlier, in 1983, my wife and I, well, she was pregnant, but we were expecting our first child. And we did all those great things that you do. I even went to all the doctor appointments. We had lists of questions. We knew all the stuff. We had this thing nailed. And just the Mother's Day weekend, Mother's Day is going to show up, you can tell. I built the changing table. My mother had just repapered the little bitty bedroom in the parsonage. Lovely, pale green. We weren't guessing on the gender thing. And we the next week, we went to the doctor's appointment where, you know, they check in on, and she's, you know, real big because she's 8 months now, a little more. And the doctor listens and can't locate the heartbeat. Calls her supervisor in. He can't locate it either. You need to go into town. Ultrasound. We'll find it. 25 miles, longest 25 miles in my life. And there wasn't one. As happens from time to time, babies die in utero. And our first son, Enoch, was born on May 27th, 1983. Just like every other baby, by the way. I only tell you that so I can tell you this part of the story, because in a small town where we lived and I served, everybody kind of knows you, and the word got around. We didn't hide it by any means. At any rate, as I'm taking my morning walk, I run into Father Brendan, one of the three clergy in town. There's the Congregationalist, the Catholic, and me. And Father Brendan sees me, greets me, and he shakes my hand. He's older than me, and with a kind of avuncular tone, says two words: God's will. Fortunately, another day, a member of the women's religious order, the Sisters of the Blessed Virgin, Sister Therese, with a Quebecois accent and about 90 years old, walking around, sees me and she said, "When I heard what happened to you, I shook my fist at God." Which one was Eliphaz? Which one was Job? I'm not here to tell you about my suffering, but to see that there is still present in the world, every time we say everything happens for a reason, or it's God's will, we're in essence saying, you deserved it. I don't think I deserve to lose a child. I didn't deserve to lose two, which is also a fact, but we'll have that story another time. But that sets you to thinking about the riddle of suffering. And of course, one of the great books on suffering in recent years that used the book of Job was When Bad Things Happen to Good People by Harold Kushner, a great man. He talked about this riddle. He lost a child to a bizarre syndrome called progeria. It makes you wonder, why do bad things? When? It isn't even why do bad things happen. He doesn't answer that question. The title is When Do. Now, he's not the only one. We're stuck in a world, even without God, when people think it's your responsibility. Anyone here know Barbara Ehrenreich? She's an author. She wrote a book called Bright Sighted about her experience with breast cancer. This quote I have to read: "The failure to think positively can weigh on a cancer patient like a second disease." She goes on, "Breast cancer, I can now report, was a very personal, agonizing encounter with an ideological force in American culture that I had not been aware of before, one that encourages us to deny reality, submit to misfortune, and blame ourselves for our fate." Because if you don't have happy thoughts, your cancer will get worse, right? It may not involve God's justice, but it involves your responsibility for being well. You don't want to go on medical welfare, do you, and need someone else to cure you? Yeah. That's a very tempting option, to think that it does work out evenly and you get what you deserve, but we know that isn't true. There are other ways to look at suffering, and I'm going to cover a little bit of them today and a little bit of them tomorrow. There's some great quotes I ran into. They're just marvelous, but I'm running out of time. But I do want to give you Victor Hugo, since we are doing so much stuff around Les Mis. He writes, let me find it here. Oh, I can't find it. Darn, I know I wrote it down. He says, and this is his religious point of view, that in the darkness, the eye dilates to take in light. In suffering, the soul dilates to take in God. It's one of several that talk about how suffering is a, if not a trial, it is a passage, an opportunity, whether we want it or not, to look at our lives differently than we might have. How many of you have had a crisis in your life? All of you, you don't have to raise your hand, 100%. Was it at that moment you remembered that what mattered was the spouse, the child, the parent, the neighbor? When you had a problem and your friend that you thought was a friend didn't talk to you because they didn't know what to say, and you realized that shows you how much of a friend they are, and the stranger who did talk to you became the friend. Suffering, they say the time assuages, writes Emily Dickinson. Time never did assuage, and actual suffering strengthens as sinews do with age. That's a common notion, that suffering is a trial. Maybe to get into heaven, I made it. Or to train you in certain ways. I don't know about any of these, and I'm running out of time. But I want to give you my point, and then one more story, and then we'll be done. My point is, we all have to suffer. The question is, will your suffering define your life, or will your life define your suffering? We all know the former, people who carry the burden of their sufferings with them forever forward. If only I shouldn't. They're literally weighed down by an affliction, and they wear it, and it becomes their life. And then there are others for whom their lives are transformed into another life that they rejoice in. Viktor Frankl, a great man, therapist, who wrote Man's Search for Meaning, I believe, lived through the Holocaust and wondered, why did some give up and die, and why did some prevail? And he said, those that prevailed thought there was some meaning to life even when they couldn't find it, while those who didn't thought there was no meaning even to their suffering. I don't know where we get meaning from suffering, but I know it isn't going to come out of the sky, and it won't come out of the minister, and it won't come out of a book. It'll come out of your own heart. It has to be born there. Will your suffering define your life, or will you define your suffering with your life? And now comes the story. So you might remember I talked about Greg a couple of weeks ago. He's the guy who showed me the dirty pictures under the road. If you weren't here, you missed a great story. He showed me where some guys had done some explicit drawings out of sight about how sex works, which in my world, when your parents gave you a book, you learned all about ova and sperm and zygotes, and you got to look at all the anatomy inside the skin, but the mechanics, not so much. So Greg had this opportunity for me to do some learning, and we were already close friends. We had been in class together. We were in the same Boy Scout troop. He was the patrol leader, then I was. And then his father was transferred to California, and they were moving. And we were by ourselves, taking a hike, and he wanted to kiss me. I don't mean like a brotherly kiss. He wanted the full-on, lip-smacking, I love you kind of kiss. And I wouldn't. Now, I wasn't offended, I was just mystified, because I never thought of him that way, but clearly he thought about me that way. I didn't have the word for gay, I didn't have the word for homosexual, I had no clue. I just know that what he wanted, I couldn't give. And I know I broke his heart that day. So I want you to think for a moment before I conclude this story about the time you stood up for yourself or were true to yourself and you still hurt someone's feelings. If you're a parent, no, you may not go out tonight. I hate you! Fine. But your heart broke when you said it, didn't it? You did the right thing and someone still hurt. You do that with your neighbors. You do that with your children, with your spouse, with your parents, with your boss, with your children. Even when you do the right thing, sometimes people can suffer. That's the first lesson. Second, I felt bad about not being able to love Greg back the way he loved me. But something came of it. I knew I was straight. Really knew. No romantic interest in men whatsoever. Which meant gay guys don't scare me at all. Homophobia literally is the fear of gay people. And there are a whole lot of men who just get creeped out. What does he think of me? Why is he looking at me like that? I don't want to be in a locker room with a gay man because he might look at me. And I want to say, I don't get that. Because I know that's not my problem. It's cool when you know what you are because then you don't have to worry about what you aren't. And that is what allowed me to go into Woody's hospital room and grab his hand and kiss him. And Axel and Alan. To rejoice with my friends in New York last March when I performed my first legal wedding of two wonderful women. A couple of men that didn't get legally married but are nonetheless hitched as well as I can hitch them down by the thorn apple this past spring. In other words, this is because of Greg. Because he loved me and I couldn't love him, I can love those that others will not love. That's how suffering works. You take the suffering and you let it make you into someone better than you were before. You let it make you. You got to suffer. You're going to have to do the suffering. You got to do the heartbreak. You got to do the misery. But if you do, you become a person, a real person. I got a great last word here. I'm just looking for it. I don't even know where I put these things anymore. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You don't mind if I look this up, do you? I wish I knew what I was doing some days. I'm completely lost, but then again, that's not news. Terry Tempest Williams, the author, writes, "The Buddha says there are two kinds of suffering, the kind that leads to more suffering, and the kind that brings an end to suffering." I hope the pain I gave Greg has been matched by the love I have given others. Because love is the only cure for suffering. Love is the only cure for suffering. May these words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be found true in thy sight, thou who art my rock and my redeemer. And amen.
One.